I am a byproduct of the culture, man, of hip hop, man. I love hip hop from the beginning to the end. Like, I'm definitely a student in the game when it comes to hip hop. Like, I literally just got to listening to 50 Cent book because I really resonate with his story. Hustle Harder, great book. 8 hour listen to on Audible. People should go check it out. I think every aspiring artist should go listen to it. Because the main thing that I get from it is evolution. And we all constantly evolving. So that's a really big thing, man. I think I just really love hip hop. Every aspect of it, you know, the drama. Tupac is my favorite artist because he, to me, embodies every aspect of hip hop, from black consciousness to gangsta, you know, the bad parts and the good parts. He embodied every single one. And I believe that's what makes him the GOAT of hip hop.
You just keep going, and one day you're going on without me, time. You just keep going, and one day you're going on without me, time. You just keep going, and one day you're going on without me, time. Time, time, where you going? Come back. Every coin got two sides, every sword got two edges.
What's going on, everybody? It's your boy, AKJ, coming to you live with another episode of Sunday Profile. And this week we have Mr. Justin Holmes. He is the, are you the executive producer or the founder? And
the CEO, one and only cinematographer of 35 Multimedia.
There we go. So welcome to the show, sir, Mr. Justin Holmes.
Appreciate it. Appreciate you having me. You know, I know this is going to be a good one. Two intellectual brothers coming together and putting out the knowledge, and that's what it's about.
Oh, yeah, most definitely. So as you know, what's been going on in this current pandemic we got going on with the COVID-19, and then we have George Floyd, and we have just a lot going on, police brutality. I want to get your insight on, like, how you feel about what's going on in, like, the country, you know, being a black man, a young black man.
Right. So I have definitely been pro-protest for a long time. You know, I was out there doing the Mike Brown riots and protests. You know, I was younger then. So, you know, it was interesting to be out there, you know, and watch it on the news. And then it was different than now because it was like one, like, area. Like, I stayed, like, off of Goodfellow and West Florissant back then. And, you know, nobody was concerned over there with their houses and stuff getting burned down. So it was way different. But when I seen the George Floyd thing, I seen one picture and I seen the crowd that was out there. And I was really like, nah, this is different. I'm like, it's way more people. And, you know, they burning down things all over the nation. So since then, my perspective has grown a lot more. You know, I became, you know, more of a guy looking at economics and business, you know, way more than I used to, and not just, you know, kind of like that socialist view that a lot of, you know, our pro-woke brothers get. So ever since then, man, I understand, man, people got to feed their families and stuff. So, you know, the looting and rioting, I used to be for, but ever since, you know, I realized, man, they burning down like Family Dollar, man. I've never seen a white person work at Family Dollar. Like, that was a black job. You know, we preoccupy these jobs. And, you know, the Quick Trip they initially burned down in Ferguson, you know, those are two black people in there, you know, and we're destroying the jobs. I don't really care about the institutions per se, because we don't own them, because black people stay in neighborhoods, not communities, being that we don't control the resources that come in and out of these neighborhoods in which we live in. So that's my opinion. I don't really agree with the looting just because it takes away from jobs and stuff that's in the area. And, you know, the whole goal is to leverage those jobs to try to, you know, pursue your own piece of the American pie. So that's my perspective. I used to be for the looting. I'm completely out of the movement as of right now, because they killed that brother who was trying to protect the, I believe it was a pawn shop, ex-police officer in St. Louis, Missouri. I can't be behind that. And for them to keep protesting, I feel like any organizer to keep pushing the narrative, if a riot ensue and someone else get killed, the blood has to be on their hands, because at this point, all four officers have been arrested, and we kind of like at a point where we kind of at overkill.
So since all of, like this stuff has happened, how has it affected you as like just like a person? Like how has it changed you?
That's a good question. So I don't think I've been in this mindset for a long time now, so I don't really think it's changed me as a person or whatever. You know, I've been not liking the police. You know, I don't believe in the whole good cop, bad cop thing. You know, because they help perpetuate the system, the status quo, and people try to, you know, individualize it. Like, oh, I know good cops. They might be good individuals, but the position is meant to serve the rich and oppress the poor. So even though you might be like, oh, well, he did this act and he let me go, or that guy was selling drugs and he didn't arrest him. Sure, those are individual acts, but the system as a whole, I like to compare it as, you know, doing Hitler. His whole thing is he sent out the troops. Now, were there good troops or whatever? Of course, individuals, but the occupation is what harbored the evil and allowed, you know, for the devastation to take place. So I believe the same thing when it comes to the United States of America, cops and police departments. So
you sound like you are in like the political, like you have like a political like mindset. So are you involved in like the 2020 presidential race or politics in general in some
other area? I used to be heavy into politics and stuff as far as the research and stuff. But honestly, man, you know, I feel like a lot of that stuff is just buffoonery, man, because, you know, rich people don't care about voting, to be honest, man. If you really study them and ask them, they don't really, like, help with movements on voting. Because either way, they can influence the party, no matter what side, Democrat, Republican, Independent, it doesn't matter. You know, one of the lowest voting communities is the Asian community, and they have the strongest hold over the political forces. So that lets me know, I feel like we've been, you know, bamboozled. It's basically something, you know, we've been led astray, basically. And ultimately, the goal is to get rich, is to get this money. And, you know, our people get confused with these things, but it's time to learn the philosophies of getting wealthy and focus on that and not focus on, you know, these emotional isolated situations, in my opinion.
So do you believe in voting, or are you?
Nah, I don't believe in voting. I think voting on a local level works, right? Because those are the people who control, you know, legislation that directly affects you. So sure, I believe in voting on a local level. I even believe in voting for Congress, but you know, the presidential thing, like nobody can tell me how the president is actually elected. You know, people running out and, you know, if you actually look at the definition of a republic, you'll see that, you know, the definition of a republic, basically when the leaders pick the leader, you know. So that is exactly what the Electoral College does for the president. I don't think people have involvement. And even when you read some of the quote unquote founding fathers' philosophies on why they came up with, people would say, indirect democracy. The whole idea was they believed that regular people were idiots, so they didn't want them voting for the leader of the free world.
That's interesting. Yeah, I'm trying to learn different things about, like, you know, politics now, and the more and more I'm just trying to just do my own thing and, you know, get my own money and sort of not really depend on the government as before. So I understand that. With your company, 365 Media,
35 Multimedia,
35 Multimedia. I'll be yep. All over the place. I'll always be doing that. So what inspired that? Like what do you think about that?
The name comes from 35mm. That comes from my first lens. So it was a 35mm lens, and then I spend it to basically be 35 Multimedia, and then I think of myself as a powerhouse on media, so multiple different areas of media, so multiple media, and then, you know, productions, of course, right? Because I deal in film and, you know, script writing, commercials, videography, photography, all forms of media. So funny part is Kevin Durant actually has a 35 mm as a 35 mm production, obviously because his jersey is 35 mm. So when I ran across there recently, I thought that was funny.
Well, I mean, like, was like when you started it, like, what? Like, what'd you think about, like, when, like, I wanted to start doing, like, you know, like, films and stuff like that? Like, what was, like, the initial idea, like, or what happened to make it happen?
I always knew, man, since I've been about 14, that I wanted to be rich. I knew I wasn't a regular person. That's always been a pursuit. And I know it's not necessarily about the money, but, you know, about the purpose, you know, and just finding that vehicle to get to that place where you're able to help more people. And that's my ultimate purpose in life, man, is I want to really, like, not necessarily change adults per se, but I want to be able to get in a position where I'm able to influence the content to help push a more woke narrative for our people, you know, because, you know, our people are, like, 90% of the entertainment world. So I think the best way to reach our people is not through debating in the streets and protesting. Is going to be through content creation.
Well, why do you where do you get this woke mindset? When did it first start? Like, I mean, like, most young people, like, you know, they just started now when they, like, all the George Floyd, you know, stuff happened. But, like, when did it start for you?
Yeah, I know a lot of people that woke up doing the Mike Brown thing. I thought it was funny. I was 14 years old. I usually don't put this out there, but I was 14 years old, and one of my friends had questioned me about some things or whatever. And, you know, it just really made me think. And he told me to go listen to the song. I'm not going to say the song because somebody going to look this up or whatever later in the future. And they're going to reference this back. But really good song. And basically, it's not, you know, sonically appeasing, but it had the history of, like, of just Black people in America, what racism came from, and talked about, you know, the origins of a lot of religions and stuff that we follow. Yeah. And then different stuff like that. So made a good source for me to start to research. And then I built my knowledge up after that. I'm going to say the artist is Raz Cass. So, you know, most people who look it up, they're going to know what I'm talking about.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah. So what inspired, what made you, like what, like, who inspired you to be Justin Holmes, like, or who inspired you to be, you know, yourself?
That's a good question, man. I am a byproduct of the culture, man, of hip hop, man. I love hip hop from the beginning to the end. Like, I'm definitely a student of the game when it comes to hip hop. Like, I literally just got to listening to 50 Cent book because I really resonate with his story. Hustle Harder, great book. 8-hour listen to on Audible. People should go check it out. I think every aspiring artist should go listen to it, because the main thing that I get from it is evolution, and we all constantly evolving. So that's a really big thing, man. I think I just really love hip hop, every aspect of it. You know, the drama. Tupac is my favorite artist because he, to me, embodies every aspect of hip hop, from Black consciousness to gangsta. You know, the bad parts and the good parts, he embodied every single one, and I believe that's what makes him the GOAT of hip hop.
Now, earlier before we started recording, you were talking about that you work with, like, the church, stuff like that. Are you, like, a deeply religious person, or are you, that's just something, you're just a good person to work with or partner with?
Right, so man, I used to be real heavy on, like, bashing people's stuff, man, real heavy when I was younger, but I no longer do that. You know, I believe that my life is meant to serve the people, no matter what nationality, race, or religion, you know, you may be. So my goal is to serve the people. As far as my personal belief set, I believe I study our ancient ancestors, so I'm more of a comedic science person as far as my particular belief system, and that's what I'm also referenced to when it comes to my spiritual guidance.
Okay, well, are you working on anything new now, or yeah?
Or so right now, I'm in the midst of opening up my brand new office space. I'm interviewing for a secretary right now at this moment. I just had a sit down with a interior designer as well, so we're going to be over you know, the way we're going to lay out the space. Is it going to be very exclusive? I'm really focused on the experience of my clients this go around. I went back to the town that raised me, which is Jennings, Missouri, real good area, whatever. I'm a Jennings alumni. I found an office space I'd be renting out of, which is the old candy store. We used to do a lot of bad stuff in front of there. I really felt like it was a great story. It also connects me with that community. So I can see myself, since I'm on the campus of the community, you know, shooting 30, 40 prom pictures, stuff like that, heavy traffic on the road. You know, it's definitely premium real estate for what I look to do as far as growing my first million-dollar company. So,
Before we go, what's going to be in it for you in the future? What can you see?
For me in the future, you're probably going to see some. I don't know what the movie industry going to go. So I was doing a lot of screenings. I've rung out like thousands of people to my showcases and stuff. So I was real heavy into that. So it's going to be interesting to see where the market goes as far as screenings and, you know, sit down theaters and stuff. Hopefully it'll be, you know, back to normal after in 2021 at the top of it. So we'll see. But that's where you're going to see a lot of films, a lot of production stuff. I'm going to get into my YouTube game this year, you know, blogging about different things, about photography, business, entrepreneurship, stuff like that. So, but my main thing is going to be just focusing on and for the next 8 months on my clientele and really growing at my facility and getting it known and then picking up my first, you know, 10 plus employees.
I wish you luck with that. You got any like lasting words for the audience? Any words of encouragement?
So today on Facebook, I was talking about entrepreneurship. So there's a lot of misconceptions out there. You know, don't let people trick you. A lot of black leaders out there telling people, you know, build your dreams or you'll forever build other people's, and you know, quit your job, or you know, a 9 to 5 is a death sentence. You know, don't listen to that stuff, because at the end of the day, how can I employ people if I'm telling people to quit their jobs? Like, that don't make sense. So everybody work their position. Everybody don't have to be bosses, man. I've seen this one lady quit her. She was, you know, $200,000 in the corporate world, and she quit her job. You know, silly. It's like, you know, to go and work for herself. And the continuous grind that you have to do as an entrepreneur, the education part of it, the working for people part of it, the filling everything out, you know, it's very difficult. Like, I wouldn't wish entrepreneurship on my worst enemy, because the biggest thing is overcoming the mindset, right? Mm-hmm. So you quit your 40 hours a week to work 80 hours a week for yourself, and the payoff is not as much, and it takes you a lot longer to get there. When you can leverage that person's who you're working for, they financing you, and leverage that income in order to, you know, fund your dream on the other side, and you don't necessarily have to quit your job. A lot of misconceptions out there as far as us quitting, us believing that we're going to quit our job and go and work for ourselves. You will never work for yourself, because other people have the money that you want. So that means if I'm a photographer, somebody books me, I work for them. If I'm selling hair products, I work for my clients who I'm selling the products to. You will never work for yourself. There's no such thing. You have to work. You have to service the people. So that's my whole like analysis of, you know, a lot of people out here, you know, still you can invest and work a job. Just don't get caught in the rat race of a 9 to 5. You know, if you're making, you know, $10-$11 an hour, you're in the rat race. But it's about, you know, going ahead and purchasing books and programs and educating yourself, and stop worrying about if the program work or not, if the book work or not. You're supposed to invest in yourself to the point, you know, let the cup runneth over, right? You're supposed to invest into yourself to the point where your income starts to rise because your skill set rises. And then when it makes sense for you to leave the job, sure, but make sure that you nurture that that mindset first and foremost.
I like that. I like that. I appreciate that. Where can we find you on social media platform?
So you can find me 35 Multimedia on any platform. Justin Holmes is my Facebook page. I got 5,000 friends, so you know, you can't add me on there. But 35MULTIMEDIA, all platforms. Check me out. We can lock in.
All right, Mr. Justin Holmes, I thank you all for tuning in. I'll see y'all next time. It's your boy AKJ coming to you live. And we out.
Time. You just keep going. And one day you're going on without me. Time. You just keep going. And one day you're going on without me. Time. You just keep going. And one day you're going on without me. Time. Time, time, where you going? Come back. Every coin got two sides. Every sword got two.